How does that feel to be the go-to story man in the industry?
Well, I don't feel that way, and actually, you know, I'm just so focused on work on a day-to-day basis and on the current project and the next project, and I never step back and look at myself and look at the past and look at this and that. I just work. But there are more and more people who seem to have built on the seeds that we planted with Indigo Prophecy and Heavy Rain, and that's definitely a good thing. I'm proud of all the games I made, and I'm not saying they are perfect or in any way. I'm just saying they remember me a moment in my life and where I was at the time. And the only thing I'm pretty sure is that I did everything I could on each of them. It's like watching a picture of you, you know, 20 years ago and mm-hmm. saying, okay, this is what I look like.
So with Beyond then, what were the major themes that you were interested in?
Beyond, you know, the starting point was really a very sad moment in my life as I lost someone I felt really close to. Beyond probably, you know, what was probably born in a cemetery actually with a coffin, you know, going into this grave. And it's a very, very, very sad and moving moment. And I just thought, okay, what do I have to say about this experience? What else can I say about death that has not been said before? And then the project took a slightly different direction, and it became also about growing, about learning, about accepting who you are, and about how the different moments in your life makes you who you are. And all this journey until this final moment that we will all have to face at some point.
How experimental do you feel? Do you feel like, let's just try this and see if it works? Are you sure, like even going back to Heavy Rain, are you confident in your approach that this is gonna work for players?
Never, never ever. I mean, if you do my job and you're 100% sure of all the decisions you make, you probably make tons of mistakes and you're probably quite stupid. No, I mean, doubts is something that goes with me every single minute. From the moment I have the very first idea to the moment where I release the game. No, I'm never sure of anything. I just challenge every idea, and I just question myself all the time. Am I doing the right thing? Is it the right decision? My approach to game design is to say, okay, there are paradigms and rules in video games that I know, that I understand, and that many people out there master very well. But no, let's explore new directions, let's try new ideas and see where it leads. And maybe it leads nowhere. But when you have this approach, it implies that you accept the idea that you may just fail, that you may try things that, you know what, they don't work. And fair enough, because failing is a part of trying, I guess. And sometimes you succeed and you find something that is truly interesting, but it's like, you know, looking for gold in the desert, you just try to dig when your instinct tells you that maybe there's something. And most of the time there's nothing. Sometimes you find something. Well, there are so many mysteries in game design, you know. And what also is interesting with games is that we have so much to explore, because the industry, for whatever reason, seem to have really focused on the same themes, the same stories, the same types of characters. It's only a tiny part of what interactivity means. Interacting doesn't necessarily mean killing someone. It may mean just changing something in your environment or that will have consequences. And this is what is fascinating about it. It's the fact that you can make decisions that will change what's going on. Mm-hmm. And that's what's so fascinating about this medium. I think Fumeto Ueda's work is obviously a landmark in the industry. And people paid attention, which is great. I think Journey was a landmark. What that game company does is very interesting and innovative and different. And people paid attention. There are games like Papo and Yo, for example, is a game I really love. And I don't think that the industry paid enough attention to that. They just say, oh, the jumping system, the camera, and yeah, wait a minute. I mean, this is not what the experience is about. And I think this game has not been seen enough and understood enough. What I love with Eco was the relationship with the little girl. Okay, there were some platform stuff and some fighting stuff. That was good. But what I really appreciated at the time was how this relationship with a little girl was established, and how it was maintained through time and with a nice narrative arc, and how it led to an incredible ending. What amazed me is that he managed to tell this very simple story, when you think about it, in a very elegant way, mm-hmm. and with almost no dialogue. So everything was just through imagery and sound and animations, and I thought that was incredibly elegant.
Sure.
And there was a sense of poetry in what he did that is really rare in the industry. And this, most of these things I found again in Shadow of the Colossus. But what is great is you really feel when you play one of these games that you have in front of you another, and not another game designer. You know, is really someone visionary, someone sensitive, someone who has a vision, was something to say in his own very own way.
Have you ever spoken with him?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Are you in a relationship where you can call him up and talk about game design? Or?
We're not friends, but we met a couple of times in Japan, and it was a great honor for me to meet him, and we talked about our game. He played Heavy Rain and apparently really enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it was fantastic. And I was very interested to meet him in person and realize that he was in his 40s like I am, and I think it has a lot to do with the games we make. I don't think that he could have done Eco when he was 20, and I don't think I could have written Heavy Rain when I was 20. I think there is something about game designer getting older which make us very boring for a young audience, but at the same time we hope we become more, we try to create things that are maybe deeper and more meaningful for people interested in that aspect of the game. Maybe game designers don't express enough, and maybe gamers are not aware of that, but it's something very natural to say, look, I started playing games when I was 10, okay? I was pretty much born and raised with video games, and since then I played pretty much every game out there on every single platform. But now I'm 44. Don't expect me to design the same games than when I was 20 or 30, just because maybe I don't listen to the same music. I don't have the same interest in films. I don't watch the same films now than when I was 15. My taste have changed. My points of interest have changed. And it's only normal that it reflects in my work. I don't feel like I'm the only game designer in the world feeling that way. I talk to many game designers in the industry, and they all say exactly the same thing. They say, you know what? Some of them tell me, I'm tired of making the same games. I wish I could do what you do and just do whatever I have in my mind, and that would be very different.
Mm-hmm.
My answer is always, why don't you do it? You know, the market gamers expect this and that, and my publisher and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, but at the same time, this industry won't change if you just give people what they expect.
Mm-hmm.
Give them something different. And you will realize that maybe this is what they wanted.